if you've had American government or political science class, some of this might be review or at least sound familiar to you, but it's a foundational chapter for the rest of the semester. We'll talk about terms like common law. You're going to hear that again in subsequent chapters. The slides and presentation is not a replacement for reading the textbook. We skip the examples and a lot of the cases in the presentation. So you're going to want to make sure you read the complete chapter. Let's start out with a definition of law. Law is enforceable rules governing relationships among individuals and between those individuals and their society. It includes rights, duties, and privileges that are consistent with the values and beliefs of a society. First source of American law is constitutional. It's based on the text of the federal or U.S. Constitution and state constitutions. And the U.S. Constitution is the supreme law of the land. The next source of American law is statutory law. These are laws that are enacted by federal and state legislatures and even go down to the local level. They're called ordinances. And there's even been some attempt among the states to create uniform laws. For example, the Uniform Commercial Code, or UCC, that governs the sale of goods. Next source of American law is administrative law. This includes rules, orders, and decisions from administrative agencies at both federal and state level. They could be independent regulatory agencies, for example, the Food and Drug Administration. The final rules are published in the Federal Register. An example of this would be the Dodd-Frank Act. The purpose of the administrative law is to ensure that the rules that are created are based on consideration of relevant factors rather than being arbitrary and capricious. This power of administrative agencies includes the ability to conduct inspections and testing, issue subpoenas, and search warrants. The last source of American law we'll talk about is case law or common law, and I'll use those terms interchangeably. It is rules and decisions that are made by courts, and it covers all areas of law not covered by statutory administrative law. It's based on early English law or the King's Court. The King's Court established common law as a body of general legal principles applied throughout the English Empire. And we still have, in fact, this is the biggest body of law we have today. It's based on this idea of precedent, which is the practice of deciding new cases based on prior ones. And controlling precedent means a higher court's decision has a binding authority in lower courts. In some cases, higher courts do depart from precedent. There's also this idea of stare decisis, which means stand on decided cases. So courts don't reinvent the wheel. They tend to decide the same type of case the same way to be consistent, and lower courts need to follow suit. Remedies are defined as the enforcement of a right or compensating for an injury to that right. One type of remedy is a remedy at law. This is basically awarding money or property. Remedies in equity are different. It's based on justice and fair dealing, or doing what's right. Some examples include specific performance, which is an order of the court making the other party do what they already promised to do. An injunction, which might be an order preventing somebody from doing something. Or rescission, which is undoing a promise or a contract, is an example. Today, you don't need to go to separate courts to get a remedy at law or equity. They're merged together. And you can even ask for both remedies in the same case. Law is classified in some major areas. For example, substantive versus procedural law. Substantive law would be your rights. And we're going to talk more about the Bill of Rights later. But a procedural law would be more about how to get those rights. So, example, we have a right to an attorney. Procedurally, that would mean the court would inquire as to whether we have an attorney and appoint one to us. In some cases, we're not able to afford one. Civil versus criminal law. Civil rights are private, and they're between people or their government. We were talking about that earlier. Criminal law is basically private individual versus the public, or in other words, public wrongs against society. National law is a particular nation, and international law involves written and unwritten laws between nations. Let's look at the constitutional powers of government. Federal form of government was a political compromise between those who wanted state sovereignty and those who wanted a more centralized government. Probably have heard of separation of power before when we look at the legislative, executive, and judicial branch. In the kind of legal arena, we look at the legislative branch as the branch that enacts the laws, executive enforces the laws, and the judicial branch interprets the laws or declares those laws or actions constitutional or unconstitutional. Let's look specifically at the Commerce Clause. Under the U.S. Constitution, the Constitution gives the Congress the power to regulate commerce with foreign nations, among the several states, and with Indian tribes. And from that, we get among the several states to mean interstate commerce. This is Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution. It has the greatest impact on business than any other constitutional provision. I mean, it's called the Commerce Clause. The U.S. Supreme Court has interpreted the Commerce Clause over a long period of time. Initially, in Gibbons v. Ogden, the court determined that commerce meant all business dealings that substantially impact more than one state. And this gave the national government the exclusive power to regulate interstate commerce. They even went so far in Wickard versus Filburn to say that a farmer who produced their own wheat and then consumed it would impact interstate commerce because it would take bread out of the mouth of interstate commerce. That was a pretty broad interpretation. In 64, in the Heart of Atlanta versus U.S. case, there was a challenge to the Civil Rights Act saying it was too broad and impacted activities that were purely local. However, motels are part of interstate commerce and people tend to stay at motels for that purpose. So that was an unsuccessful challenge. Today, theoretically, the Constitution hasn't changed. The federal government still has the power to regulate any business where there is a substantial effect on interstate commerce. But actually, the Supreme Court, through a number of cases, has curbed the federal power and given the states some power to regulate in areas that may impact interstate commerce. There is broad regulatory power to the states through the 10th Amendment. All powers that aren't expressly given to the national government or federal government are reserved to the state. This includes police powers, which is broader than just the police and includes the area of health, safety, morals, and general welfare. The text also mentions the Dormant Commerce Clause. The U.S. Supreme Court has interpreted Commerce Clause to give national government the exclusive power to regulate. And states only have a dormant or negative power to regulate interstate commerce. But today there's more of a balancing of the state's interest versus a national interest. For example, there wasn't the internet back when the Constitution was framed, so there could be a federal regulation that impacts states, but there also could be a state law that impacts interstate commerce, but the court might determine that the state has a significant interest in that. For example, taxing goods that are purchased on the internet. The Constitution says that the laws, treaties of the United States are the supreme law of the land. So in an area where Congress has been given power, they can exclusively regulate. In some cases, there's concurrent power, which means both the state and federal government share power. But if it's an area that Congress has the power, then even if it's an area of concurrent power, federal law preempts the state law. Look at the Bill of Rights from the aspect of business. Originally, the Bill of Rights only applied to the federal government. It was 10 written guarantees of protection of individual liberties from government interference. Today, the Bill of Rights applies to the states, and some of those protections apply to businesses. And as we go through them, we'll focus on how they relate to business. First, look at the First Amendment, specifically freedom of speech. A right to free speech is the basis for our democratic government. Speech doesn't include just what we say, it includes symbolic speech. For example, gestures, movements, or articles of clothing. And in the Texas v. Johnson case, that was a Supreme Court case about burning the flag as symbolic speech. The U.S. Supreme Court has permitted reasonable restrictions on speech. Balancing the government's obligation to protect the community versus an individual's right to speak freely. There's even corporate political speech. Corporations have protected political speech, can financially support candidates. Commercial speech, such as marketing or advertising, is given substantial protection. Any restrictions by the government must first seek to implement a substantial government interest. Second, directly advance that interest. And third, go no further than necessary to accomplish that purpose. An example is Bad Frog Brewery versus the New York State Liquor Authority. This was a Michigan brewery that had a frog on its label with its middle finger up. And the New York State Liquor Authority, which was a governmental action, denied their label. And the court determined that that was unconstitutional because it lacked a reasonable fit with the state's interest in shielding minors from vulgarity. Basically, there's other ways of preventing minors from seeing this label than just banning it. Not all speech is protected. For example, the Supreme Court has said that defamatory speech or threatening speech or obscene speech is not protected under the Constitution. Obscene speech is defined as patently offensive, violates community standards, and has no literary, artistic, political, or scientific merit. And this includes regulating speech online. For example, there's been several acts that relate to filtering the internet in public places like libraries and schools, and even regulating child pornography. And there's a lot different speech online than there is face to face. And one area that's getting a lot of attention is hate speech. For example, even bullying online. Freedom of religion under the First Amendment guarantees that Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. So it doesn't say that there has to be a complete separation of church and state. Instead, it prohibits Congress from establishing a religion or giving preference to one religion or another, and allows the free exercise of religion. basically guaranteeing that a person can hold any practice or no religious practice. And it really relates to the government's interference with the free exercise, not individuals. There was an example in a textbook of Mitchell County versus Zimmerman, where a local ordinance banned steel cleats on roads, and the court determined that that was a unconstitutional restriction of the free exercise of religion because it was directed specifically at Mennonites. Due process is basically the idea that the government decision to take away life, liberty, or property needs to be fair. It requires notice and a fair hearing. The substantive part of due process focuses on the content of the legislation or the right itself. And really, the amount of tension the court gives it depends on whether it's a fundamental or non-fundamental right. The action or law is given a lot more scrutiny if it's a fundamental right and it requires a compelling state interest, versus if it's a non-fundamental right that is only a rational relationship is required. Equal protection, the government is to treat similarly situated individuals or business in the same manner. So it doesn't have to treat everybody the same. The courts have been just said that those that are similarly situated, for example, two people convicted may not have the same criminal history or circumstances. Courts apply different tests for challenges based on equal protection, based on what interest. We've got the minimal scrutiny, intermediate scrutiny, and strict scrutiny test. Another name for minimum scrutiny is the rational basis test. So, if the government's involved and it's an economic or social welfare issue, then the government needs to show a legitimate governmental interest. If it's an allegation that the government is treating people differently based on gender or legitimacy, that you apply intermediate scrutiny, and the government has to show an important governmental interest. Strict scrutiny is applied whenever there's a fundamental right involved or some suspect trait, for example, race, and the government would need to show a compelling governmental interest for discriminating based on fundamental rights or a suspect trait. Privacy isn't specifically listed in the Constitution. The Supreme Court has implied it from the Constitution. For example, the Fourth Amendment protects us against unreasonable search and seizure, so there must have been private areas the constitutional framers worth considering. There's been a lot of case law in this area, and it's certainly in the news a lot lately. Griswold versus Connecticut was the case that found that there was a personal privacy right implied in the Constitution. It expanded on Roe v. Wade. And there are federal statutes in the area of privacy, for example, HIPAA. And technical advances certainly have had privacy implications. The slide mentions court records as public records and whether there's any expectation of privacy and the Patriot Act, but there's, that was quite a while ago, and there's even been more recent technology issues, for example, around the NSA and their ability to monitor.